So welcome to the lecture on damped dynamic vibration absorber. So we will discuss the optimal tuned damped absorber. So we derived the equations of the amplitude for the damped vibration absorber, and we saw that for certain values of damping, the response of the main system is not infinite, but it is some finite value. And we saw also that this system, that is the main system, is infinite when zeta equal to 0 and zeta equal to infinite value. And we derived for this kind of system, that is comprising machine and the damped system. So here we have this main system, and this is the absorber system. So this is M1, K1, and this is K2, C2 and M2. So and this is subjected to some harmonic force F0 sin omega t. So this is the absorber system that comprise the parameters K2, M2 and C2. So this is the absorber system. And the main system is M1 and K1. So this is the main system. And in the previous lecture for this system, we derived this equation. So X1 by delta ht, we derived, that is 2fg square plus g square minus f square. This is zeta. So 2 zeta g square plus z square minus f square whole square divided 2 fg whole square into g square minus 1 plus mu g square whole square plus mu f square g square minus g square minus 1 into g square minus f square and whole square. And this is under root. So x1 by delta ht. So x1 is, here it is x1, that is x1 e power I omega t. And delta ht is the static deflection, zero frequency deflection. So we can have this equation. So we can see from this diagram of the response of X1 that when we are just the undamped, so zeta equal to 0 means, so our system initially has omega n, that is natural frequency, and omega n is equal to, so this is for the system, so K1 by M1. So this is the natural frequency of the main system, and omega is the forced frequency. Omega is the forcing frequency. So we can see that if our main system natural frequency coincides with the forcing frequency, that is omega by omega n is equal to 1, okay, the system will have the very large response. Therefore, we attach some vibration absorber, and when we attach vibration absorber, that has the C2 equal to 0. So, if C2 equal to 0 means it is an undamped vibration absorber. And so it is an absorber. So this is my main system and this is an absorber. So this is M2, K2, M1 and K1. So it means there is no damping. And we see that when we have undamped absorber, the resonant frequencies are shifted away from the omega by omega n equal to 1, and they are here for some values of mu, that is the mass ratio m2 by m1. So these are the two resonant frequencies, maybe here near 0.9 and near 1.1. So these are the two resonant frequencies when zeta is 0. However, when zeta is infinite, that is the value of damping is infinite, we add large damping. So we have the shift in the resonant this frequency here, and the amplitude of x1 is again infinite for the value of omega by omega n near between 0.9 and 1. So now we see that for zeta equal to 0, x1 is infinite, and for zeta equal to infinite, x1 is infinite. So the x1 will be minimum between these two extreme values. And so we have to find that value of zeta and value of z, that is the omega by omega n, where this x1 will be minimum. So now we can have, so in this curve we can see the two points here. We can see two points A and B. So zeta equal to 0 curve and zeta equal to infinite curve, they are cutting at point A here and point B here. So the peak is coming at A and B. So if it means at both the value of damping, zeta equal to 0 and zeta equal to infinite, the x1 is same. X1 is equal. Therefore, we can put in this equation x1 by delta ht, 1 zeta equal to 0 and then zeta equal to infinite, and we equate these two equations to find the value of x1 corresponding to A and B. So, we put x1 for zeta equal to 0. So, what we will get? So, we will get x1 by delta ht. So, if we put zeta equal to 0, so this term is 0 and this term will be 0 because this is 0, so this whole term is 0. So, we will get g square minus f square. And this term, that is mu f square g square minus g square minus 1 and g square minus f square. Now there is a square, so here is a square and this term is squared and then under root. So this under root, they are a square term, so we will have z square minus f square divided by mu f square g square minus g square minus 1 and g square minus f square. Okay, so this is for zeta equal to 0. Now if we put zeta equal to infinite, so zeta equal to infinite, because we want to check these two values of zeta, the x1. So when zeta equal to infinite here, so this quantity will be very large, so this can be neglected. So we will have x1 by delta st equal to, we will have 2 zeta z whole square divided by, so again here if this zeta is very large, this quantity that doesn't contain zeta will be negligible. So we can write 2 zeta z whole square and g square minus 1 plus mu z square whole square and then under root. So now these two terms will be cancelled out and this is a square, so we will get this is equal to 1 by z square minus 1 plus mu g square. So we have got these two values of x1 by delta st. Okay, so this is for zeta equal to infinite and this is for zeta equal to 0. So now we see that in this curve zeta equal to 0 is going to intersect zeta equal to infinite, so at point A, so means that these two values x1 by delta st and x1 by delta at zeta equal to 0 and x1 by delta st at zeta equal to infinite should be equal to get the point A, the x1 corresponding to A or value of g corresponding to A. So now we can have so we can equate these two terms, this term and this term. So we can write g square minus f square by mu f square g square minus g square minus f square equal to 1 by g square minus 1 plus mu g square. Okay, so that is here x1 by delta st for zeta equal to 0 is equal to x1 by delta st for zeta equal to infinite. Okay, so to get points intersection points A and B. So now we can write these equations. So we will have g square minus f square into g square minus 1 plus mu g square, that is equal to mu f square g square minus g square minus 1 g square minus f square. So we are cross multiplying these terms. So we can write here, so g square into g square, so g power 4 minus g square plus mu g power 4 minus f square g square plus f square minus mu f square g square. So we multiply g square with these terms and f square with these terms. So g power 4 minus g square plus mu g power 4 minus f square g square plus f square minus mu f square g square, that is equal to mu f square g square minus, again we multiply this, so we have g power 4 minus g square f square minus g square plus f square. Now we can open this bracket, so mu f square g square minus g power 4 minus plus g square f square minus plus g square minus f square. So we can take g terms here, so g power 4 here and this is g power 4, and so g power 4 terms we collect, so here g power 4 and this will come here, so it is 2 terms, and then here is mu, so 2 plus mu, then g square terms, so we can collect the g square terms, so this is minus g square, so this is g square here and then this will be minus 2 g squares, so let's write 2 g square, then here is minus f square g square and here is plus f square g square, this will go other side, so it is twice. So g square, so f square, because g square is here, and then here is minus mu f square g square, here is mu f square g square, so it is again 2 twice, so 2 is here, so f square mu, so it is plus mu f square. Then here is g square and here is g square, so minus 2 g square, so it is plus 1. And then we have the terms, this is f square and here f square, so this will be plus 2 f square and this is equal to 0. So we can write here g power 4, this 2 plus mu g power 4 minus 2z square 1 plus f square plus mu f square plus 2f square equal to 0. Okay, so this equation we can also write g power 4 minus 2z square 1 plus f square plus mu f square upon 2 plus mu plus 2f square upon 2 plus mu equal to 0. So, now if we solve this equation, we will get the value of g. So, g square equal to minus b. So, it is minus b plus minus under root b square. So, it is b square four into one AC, so it is 2f square by 2 plus mu upon 2a. So a is 1, so it is upon 2. So we have we will get two values of g square, and so the positive values of g, so we will get two values of g, that is g1 and g2. So these will be corresponding to gA and gB, because we will get here the two values of g, and g is equal to omega by omega n. So, these are the g equal to omega by omega n. So, on this curve we will get two values of g, where the x1 will be equal for zeta equal to 0 and zeta equal to infinite. So, now we have the x1a and x1b, I mean we know that what will be the gA for a and gB for this b. Now, it is found that the most efficient absorber is the one when x1 is A is equal to x1b. So, we to satisfy this condition, there is a relation, that is f equal to 1 upon 1 plus mu. So, we have f equal to 1 upon 1 plus mu. So, mu is the mass ratio. So, the absorber is efficient when we have both these peaks A and B, they are equal, okay, means the intersection point zeta equal to 0 and infinite, that is A and B, both are equal. So, that is the most efficient absorber, and for to get this condition, f should be equal to 1 upon 1 plus mu, that is the so this is tuned when f equal to 1 upon 1 plus mu, and f is here f is omega a by omega n. So, the absorber frequency upon the system frequency, natural frequency of the main system. So, when this frequency omega a by omega n is equal to satisfies this relation, this absorber is most efficient. So, we will select f equal to 1 by 1 plus mu. Now, we have tuned the absorber because we have got some tuning between the frequencies of absorber and the system frequency. Now, we have to find the value of damping zeta that is optimal. So, the optimal value of damping for which this tuning will the tuned absorber will be working. So, that will be we call optimally tuned vibration absorber. And so, to find the value of zeta, so we can see that we have x1 a equal to x1 b here. We have satisfied this when we select f equal to 1 upon 1 plus mu. So, for certain value of mu, this plot is here, and we have x1 a equal to x1 b. But this we want to know that what will be the, because this x1 a may have some other damping value, x1 b may be also some have some other damping value. Now, we have to optimize the damping value. So, what we will do? We will now do the, so we have x1 by delta ht as function of now z, and we differentiate t x1 by delta ht. So, we differentiate with respect to g and equal to 0. So, we want to know that for which value of g. So, we know the g and g b. So, we first differentiate dx1 by dx1 by delta ht and we equate to 0. So, the objective is that we want the points a and b, this curve horizontal, so that slope is 0, and slope will be 0 when this, if we differentiate the slope of the curve is d x1 by delta ht by dg, and that is equal to 0, and when we do this, then we will find the condition for the zeta square. Okay, so we get the zeta square, so corresponding to GA. So for point A, we put GA and we will get zeta square. We are getting zeta square, the damping value corresponding to point A, that is mu 3 minus under root mu by mu plus 2 upon 8 1 plus mu cube. And corresponding to point B, we are getting damping value mu 3 plus under root mu by mu plus 2 upon 8 1 plus mu cube. Now, we have these two different damping values, but we have to select only one damping value because we have only one damping element. Therefore, we will take some average value of these two. So, average of these two, that is zeta square optimal, is we sum, so 3 mu by 8 1 plus mu cube. And when we put this optimal value in x1 by delta ht equation with zeta equal to zeta square equal to 3 mu by 8 1 plus mu cube and f equal to 1 upon 1 plus mu, and for ga and gb that we already get in terms of mu, so we will get x optimal value of x1 that is equal to root 1 plus 2 by mu. So, this is the optimal value of x1 and that is root 1 plus 2 mu. So now here we see that in case of a damped vibration absorber, the absorber, so vibrations are there, they are large. However, the main mass, the main system, so vibration are non-zero. As in case of dynamic undamped absorber, the system was coming at rest for a particular tuning frequency. But here we are getting some values of x1. For example, we got x1 by delta s t equal to root 1 plus 2 by mu, that is non-zero. And the absorber's vibrations are quite large. Okay, so we need to consider the springs, design the spring with the fatigue point of view, because that will go under fatigue loading, repetitive loading. So we should usually consider this damped vibration absorber when the operating frequency band is very narrow, then only we must apply this damped vibration absorber. So I stop this lecture and I thank you to you for attending this lecture, and see you in the next lecture.